Okay, so from today, we are starting to look at the public key system. So until last time, we looked at the CCA security and symmetric case encryption and authenticate encryption, right? So before we are starting the public key system, we will look at some number theory first, and then we'll continue about the public key system. So let's look at what we learned last time, until last time. We mainly looking at the symmetric key system. Okay. So there are two party, Alice and Bob. So they are trying to exchange the message, and we are assuming that both party have the same key. Okay. So using this key, they are trying to encryption, and also they are creating the tag value. Okay. So when Alice is sending the message, Alice can do the encryption or message authentication code MAC. Okay. For the encryption, we learn about the AES and hash. And we learned the pseudo random function, right? So we learned about this kind of thing. Actually, if we are trying to think of, let's think about whether AES is really PRF, pseudo random function or not. So we are just believing currently the AES is kind of pseudo random function, but actually we cannot prove, right? So it's not proven. So from today, we will look at the public key system. Public key or asymmetric crypto system. So symmetric crypto system case, we have to set up the shared key, okay? But how we can set up the shared key? This is the difficult part. So in the public key system, what Alice and Bob is doing is, Alice is generating the two keys. One is Alice's private key and Alice's public key. Okay, Bob is also generating the Bob's public key, Bob's private key. Okay, and then what is happening is Alice is publish the public key to see everybody. Bob is also publishing the public key. Okay, so public key Alice and public key Bob is now publicly available. So everybody can look at it. Okay. Then using these schemes, what we are trying to do is in the public key system, we are constructing the shared key, okay, using this public key value. So we will use some mathematical formulation. So the safety of this public key system is that if the design, the public key system is broken, then we can reduce the breaking algorithm to break mathematical problem. So we are believing that some mathematical problem is very hard to solve, okay? So if that problem is really hard to solve, then our public key system is safe. Okay, so normally using that approach, we will show that the security of public key system. Okay, so we will look at this public key system. Using this public key, what we are doing is we will construct key, shared key. So key, using the key exchange protocol, we are set up the shared key. Where we can do the digital signature. It's very similar to the MAC, but in the MAC case, we have to have the same key value. in the DTAR signature, different keys used, and also we will use the public key encryption. So signature encryption. Okay. So for this one, what we will learn about the some number theory for the background of this public key system. So we will define some notation for this public key system. So we will use integer only. Every case we will use integer. So integer means it's from 0 to like n minus 1, okay, or 1 to the n. So this is an integer. So here the n is denoting as a just positive integer. Okay. And normally we also use the small p, which is representing a prime number. So for instance, p equal to 3, 5, 7, 11, 13. So these are prime number. Normally p will be the 1000 bit prime. We will use this kind of large prime, okay? So we'll use this large prime. Using this integer, what we are defining is, we will defining some set Z, okay? So we are denoting the Z. Z is representing all the integer, so infinite size of set, and Gn, that is representing some G modulus N, okay? So for instance, Gn, that set means it is including 0, 1, 2, N minus 1. So that set is called Gn, okay? So for this finite set, we are defining the plus operation and multiplication by applying the modulo n. So we are just taking the remaining value. Okay, so let's look at some example. What does it mean? Let's think about the n is 12. It's like a clock. So clock has from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 12 hours. Okay, so 9 o'clock plus 8 o'clock is what? So 9 plus 8 is 17, right? But what is that? We have to the modulo 12, which is 5 o'clock, right? So this kind of operation we are defining. So 9 plus 8 is now 5. Okay, modulo 12. 5 times 7 is what? 35 modulo 12 is what? 11. Okay. 5 minus 7, which is what time is it? It's minus 2, which is 10 o'clock. Okay. So modulus. What about the distributed law in the modulus? A times B plus C mod N is equal A times B plus A times C mod N. Is it really true? What do you think about it? So let's look at some example. Nine plus eight times seven. So mod 12. It is equal to the 9 times 7 plus 8 times 7 mod 12. So what is 9 plus 8? Yeah, but it is, we are applying the modulus. So it is what? It is 5. Okay, so it's equal to the 5 times 7. Okay, which is, how much is it? 11. Actually, you can see that 17 times 14. You can see the 17 times 7, which is how much is it? 109. You can see that. What about the 9 times 7 mod 12? How much is it? 3. 8 times 7 mod 12. A plus 3 plus 8 is 11. So you can see that this is equal. So actually the distributed law is also available in this modulus operation. Okay. So in the number theory, everything is based on the modular operation. Modular arithmetic. Okay, so for this modular operation, you know that what is the plus operation, how you can do the multiplication, how you can do the subtraction, what about the division? So division is a little bit tricky. It's not easy, right? So let's look at how we can do the division in the modulus operation. So before we are continue with the modulus the division, what we are doing is we will look at the GCD, greatest common divisor. So let's look at the GCD algorithm, greatest common divisor. You already know that. So GCD 8,12, what is it? Yeah, it's 4. GCD 12,18, that is 6. GCD 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's what? 1. That is not easy, right? So there is some algorithm to compute this GCD in polynomial time, so which is Euclidean. So the Euclidean algorithm means, so how we can construct GCD of A and B, which has the common divisor, great common divisor of G. Okay, so how we can construct, how we can compute this G. So A comma B's GCD is G, then large A is actually small a times G, and large B is small b times G. Is it correct? It's correct, right? Because A and large A and B has the same factor G. Okay, so then what of the GCD? A minus B comma B, which is actually GCD small a G, small b times G comma B G. which is A minus B, G, B, G. So computing the GCD of AB, which has the same factor of large G, is equal to the small AB times G and small B times G. It's the same thing because it is also, those have the same factor G, okay? So instead of GCD of A and B, we can compute the GCD of A minus B comma B. Okay, so we can reduce the size of number. So small A minus B, B are, what about this relative prime? Relative prime means that they have no common factor except one. Is a relative prime if A, B are relative prime. So small AB doesn't have any common factor. Then what about the A minus B comma B? Are they including the common factor or not? So small GCD, the GCD of small AB is one. Then what about the GCD of A minus B times B? So let's look at what is it. A minus B, let's say this is X times K, and B is Y times K, okay? So A minus B has the K, B has K. Then what is A, small a? Small a is B plus X times K, which is Y times K plus X times K, which is X plus Y times K. So what about the A and B? So what is common factor of A and B? Common divisor, it should be. So here, in this case, there the common factor, common divisor is K, right? But the K should be what? Should be one, because small AB are relative prime. So that means A minus B and B has no common divisor. Okay, so A minus B and B are relative prime. So when we are computing the GCD of large AB, in the case, instead of just computing AB, we can do the A minus B comma B. It is also the same thing. We can apply the subtraction multiple times. That is also okay. So A minus multiple times of B is also the same thing. So which means that it is GCD A mod B. A minus X times B means we are just taking the remaining part, remainder. Okay. And then we are keep going for this part. So if the B, so now the left one is smaller than the right, so we are applying the right thing, okay. So for instance, GCD 12, 18. Then what we can do is GCD 12, 18 minus 12, which is 6. Okay. So that means GCD 12 minus 2 times 6. Okay. So GCD 0, 6. Okay. So which means that this G, 6, is common divisor. So this 6 is actually the great common divisor, GCD value. Okay, so can you do the GCD of 36 and 48 using the Euclidean? What's the GCD value? Yeah, 12. So how we can do? So GCD 36 of A minus 36, which is 12. So 36 is actually multiple of 12. So it's 12. So then using this Euclidean, you can also compute GCD 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. How much is it? Definitely it cannot be 2, right? 5, 6, 7 is 1. It's not the even number. So you can see that GCD 1, 2, 3, 4 minus 2 times 5, 6, 7, 5, 6, 7, which is GCD 100, 5, 6, 7. That means GCD 100 and minus 500, so 67. Then it is 33. So that 33 and 1. So that is GCD 0.1 is 1. Okay. So let's go to the backward direction. Backward. So one is what? One is 67 minus 2 times 33. Is it correct? So 67 minus 2 times 33. Okay, then what is 33? 33 is actually 100 minus 67. Mm-hmm. Right. So 33 is from subtraction of these two parts. Then we can rewrite it. Okay. And then let's look at the 67. 67 means actually it is 567 minus 5 times 100. Right? So by combining these two, we can construct this one. So if we are rewriting it, minus 17 times 100 plus 3 times 567. 100 is actually 1, 2, 3, 4, minus 2 times 5, 6, 7, plus 3 times 5, 6, 7. So what is it? Minus 17, 1, 2, 3, 4, plus 37, 5, 6, 7. Okay. So what we know is that minus 17 times 1, 2, 3, 4, plus 37 times 5, 6, 7 is actually 1. So for any value, for any x and y, if we are computing the GCD of these two values, then we are making something. And finally, some value is coming up. Okay. Then what we can do is, this is actually GCD value. So GCD x, y is representing using some a times x plus b times y. A, b are integer value. So for instance, GCD, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 case, it's minus 17, 1, 2, 3, 4, 37, 5, 6, 7. So for instance, GCD, 34 times 36, what is it? What's the GCD value? It is 2, right? Okay. So that means 2 can be represented using some 2 integer value. So what's the A and B? A equal minus 1, B equal 1. Okay, so similarly, GCD 12, 18, which is a 6. So 6 can be A times 12, B times 18. What's the A and B? This is a very simple case. Minus 1, 1. Is it possible to construct A times X plus B times Y is less than GCD X and Y? Is it possible? Except 0. It's not going to be possible, right? So which means that x equal 2, y equal 4. In this case, is it possible a times 2 plus b times 4 is? It's like 1. Is there a and b? A and b are existing? No, right? Because x and y is actually the both are the multiple of GCD x comma y. Okay, so anytime x times a times x plus b times y is actually there is some common factor GCD x comma y, and then there is, this is integer. So if integer is greater than one, then definitely it is greater than GCD value. Okay. So x, y is zero case. We are expecting not zero. So we are not including the zero case. Okay. Okay, so the GCD is actually the minimum unit that we can generate using the two integer value by combining linear combination of these two value. Okay, so then what does mean of integer GCD? If GCD x comma y is one, so greater common divisor is one, then x and y are relative prime. Right? And we know that it then one, and also for all x comma y. There exist A and B such that A times X plus B times Y is equal to the GCD X comma Y. So we also construct this A and B using the Euclidean algorithm. Okay, so then, so using this GCD algorithm, what we are doing is we are defining the division. Okay, so we know about the modular operation, in the modular operation, like how we can do the plus, multiplication, and subtraction. So we have to know about this division part. Okay. So division means just integer case. Integer is infinite small. Integer is infinite elements. Minus 1, 0, 1, 2. There are so many things. So here, what's the identity for multiplication? So identity means that after identity is multiplied, then it should be the same to the original x. Then what's the E for the multiplication? For the multiplication, the identity is one, right? And this division means actually it's inverse of the division means it is inverse of multiplication. So inverse means x times x inverse should be identity. Right? So x division x should be e. So that means division x is actually multiplication x inverse. Okay. So what about the inverse of 2? 2 times x equal 1. Is there x in the z? we know that x should be half 1 over 2, but x is not z, right? So we know that integer is not allowing the inverse for the multiplication, right? So integer case division is not working. So instead of the integer, what we are doing is a modulo set like a Gn. Okay, so Gn case, what we are doing is like x times x inverse should be 1 in the modulo n. Okay, so that's what we are doing. So for instance, x equal 2. So 2 division x equal 1. That means 2 multiplication of x inverse is 1 in modulo n. Okay. So that is the division things. So let's look at the n equal 17 case. 2 times x inverse is 1 both 17. What is number? Instead of this one, let's say it's just using some variable. 2 times a is 1. What is a? Okay, so 9 is what? Inverse of 2 in mod 17. Okay. So x division 2 means x times 2 inverse, which means that x times 9 in modulo 17. Okay, so instead of direct division, we are computing inverse of the element, and then we are applying the multiplication. So let's look at some example. Think about the Z13. 3 inverse is what? Which number we have to multiply to generate 1 in modulo 13? So which number? Which number? 9. So 3 times 9 is 27. Mode 13 is Z15. What's the inverse of 4? Yeah, it's 4 because 4 times 4. Mode 15 is 1. Okay, so how can you compute 9 and 4? Maybe you're trying to every case, right? For the multiplication is the multiplication is 1, right? Until it is generating 1. So instead of, we will use GCD. So using the GCD, let's try to compute the inverse value. So GCD of 3,13, what is it? That is 1. Okay, then using the Euclidean, we know that A times 3 plus B times 13 is 1, right? So what's the A and B? A is minus 4, B equal 1. So 1 is minus 4 times 3 plus 1 times 13 is 1. Right? And then what we are doing is, now for this G13, we are applying the mod 13. For both terms. So if we are dividing the left term, then so second term is multiple of 13, right? So this is minus 4 times 3 mod 13. And right one is just 1 mod 13. Right? So which is A times 3 mod 13 is 1. What is A? A is minus 4, right? We know that minus 4. But A times 3 is 1. What's the definition of inverse? Inverse 3 is actually A. Okay, so inverse of 3 is minus 4. Minus 4 mod 13 is actually same to the 9. So similarly, for the second case, what we are doing is we are computing GCD 4, 15, which is 1. So we know that 4 times 4 minus 1 times 15 is 1. We are applying the 15, modulus 15 for both case. Okay, so 4 times this 4 is inverse. So 4 inverse is 4. In both. Okay, so then how can you compute inverse of 3 modulus 17? Using the Euclidean. So what we are trying to do is, we are computing GCD 3,17. We know that this is 1. So A times 3 plus B times 17 is 1. What's the A and B? Six times 3, that's 1 times 70. Okay, and applying the modulus 17. Then inverse of 3 is 6, right? Because 3 inverse 3 is 1. So this 3 inverse is equal to the 6. Then what about the G15 and inverse of 3? Is there any number? There's no. Because what? GCD 3,15 is what? It is 3. So it's not 1, right? So we cannot construct and solve 1. So which means that we cannot make A times 3 plus B times 15 is 1. So actually, A is not existing. So inverse is not existing in mode 15 for number 3. So then definitely you know that G15 is containing 0, 1, 2, 14, right? So among these, for the multiplication, so let's assume that this is star multiplication. So that means it has inverse, okay? Among this G15, we are selecting some element which has the inverse. So which element has inverse? 1 has inverse, right? 1 times 1 is 1. Okay. What about 2? 2 times A plus 15 times B is 1. A, B are existing or not? Existing, because GCD of 250 is 1. Okay. So whatever GCD of x, 15 is 1, then x has the inverse. Right? So simply, we are just checking about the number has common factor for the modulus value. What of the 3? No, right? 3 is not. 4. It's okay. 5. GCD 5,15 is 5. So it's not. 6. 7, yes. 8, okay, 9, no, 10, because 5, 11, okay. 12, no, 13, okay, 14, okay, so actually the inverse is the case when we are selecting some x in the G15, but what is happening is GCD of x, 15 should be 1. So we are collecting all the element which has the GCD is 1. Okay. So G n star is actually what? We are collecting all the element in the Gn, but GCD of x, n is 1. So if the GCD value is 1, then it has inverse value. Okay, so then what's the G12 star? One, five, seven, 11. G8 star. Let's see, 5, 7. G7 star. One, two, three, four, five, six. G13 star. From one to okay, then what is the G P star? So P is prime. What do you think about it? Yeah, it is from one to P minus one. Because P is prime, so any number of x comma prime is one, right? If x is from the one to p minus one, because p is prime number, p can be divided by one and p only. So g p star is actually equal to the GP minus only zero value, because zero doesn't have the inverse for the multiplication. Okay. So now we are looking at this GN and also GN star. GN star means that it is collecting all the elements which has inverse for the multiplication. Okay, so we already looked at it, and it's positive number, P is a prime, and we can do the addition and multiplication, and also we can do the subtraction. So here we already look at it. Okay, so we are completing until this part. Do you have any question? Nothing? Okay. So then let's try to look at the Fermat's theorem and Euler's theorem. So we'll look at the Fermat's theorem. Let's think of the Gn. Gn means 0, 1, n minus 1. And Gn star is x in the Gn, but GCD of x comma n is 1. Okay, so first we are looking at the Fermat's literature. So the theorem is, first P is prime number, and then for all X, so this meaning is for all X in GP star. So GP star is actually from 1 to P minus 1. Right, because P is prime, so except zero, everything is there. So for every X in the GP star, if we are X to the P minus one, so we are multiplying X P minus one time, modulo P, then it is always one. Okay. So that is called Fermat's literature theorem. So for instance, G5 star, think about G5 star, and x equals 3. So that means x times p minus 1 mod p. So p is 5. C to the 4 mod 5 is 1. Yeah. 16, both 5 is 1. What about the 2? 2 to the 4, mod 5. This is 16, mod 5. What about the 4? This is also, if you are computing, this was 1. So always this is holding. Okay. So that is pretty much real literature. Okay, so we will prove this pretty much literature. Right? So let's look at how we are proving. Okay, GP star is from 1 to P minus 1. Okay, so we are taking some X value from this set. Okay, so we don't know which one, but anyway, we are just listing up the GP, so which is 1, 2, 3, 4, and P minus 1, the modulo P. So we are selecting this X and then we are multiplying X to every element. So first one is X times 1, second one is X times 2, X times 3, X times 4, X times P minus 1. Okay, and then we are applying the modulus P. Is it okay? So there are P minus one number and we are selecting any number and then multiplying the number to every element. And then we are taking the P minus one modulus. Okay. Then, so definitely this X, 2X, 3X, X P minus one, is between 1 to the P minus 1 in the mod P, right? Because we are applying the modulus, so those number is not greater than P minus 1. And also there is no element which is 0. So nothing is 0, right? Because if there is not zero, so for instance, 3 times X mod P is 0. What does it mean? This is multiple of P. So X, 3X is multiple of P, P times something. But we know that 3 is less than P, X is less than P. So this cannot be happening. Okay, so which means that every element is between 1 to the P minus 1, right? Nothing is 0. Nothing is greater than P because we are applying the mod P. So everything is between these values. Okay, and second one. So think about this number. So there is some number and there is another number. Let's assume that these numbers are, everything is different, or is there any two number which has the same value? So every number are different, or there are something equal. So like this, G5 star, that is 1, 2, 3, 4. We are selecting the 2. Then 1 times 2, 2 times 2, 3 times 2, 4 times 2, right? And then applying the modulo 5, which means this is 2, this is 4, this is 1, this is 3. So what we will look at it, we know that every number will be different, but we will prove. So let's assume that I times X times I is 4 over the x times j. So let's compare these two values. I and j are different. So for different position, one of these two values are equal. Okay. So like 4 times x times 4 is equal to the x times 7 m mod p. So we want to check it. So let's assume that x times I is equal to x times j. Then we can move this x times j to the left. So x times I minus x times j is 0, right? So that meaning is if we are grouping x times I minus j is 0. Because of district bit to the low, we can do this one. So mod p, the mod p. So this case, this one is happening when x equals 0 case. Mod p, where I minus j is 0 in mod p. Because x is prime number. There's no way the other ways, right? But we already know that x cannot be 0. Okay, so that means I should be j in mod p. But I and j are between 1 to p minus 1. So that means I should be j. Okay, so that means assumption is incorrect. So assumption means that we assume that I and j are different. Different, but the multiplication is equal. But in the case, I and j should be equal. So that means x times I is not same to the x times j. So every element are different, okay? Every element are different, and also each element is between 1 to p minus 1. How many elements here? Yeah, there are p minus 1 numbers. So that means one of them is 1, one of them is 2, right? So the position is just mixed, but every number is 1, 2, 3, 4, and p minus 1. So that means if we are multiplying x times 2x times x times x times 2, x times 3, x times p minus 1 is actually equal to the 1 times 2 times. Is it correct? In mod p. Right? Because we know that every element after modulo p, these are just between 1, from 1 to the p minus 1, and every element are different. So this one is between 1 to the p minus 1. Okay, the positions are different, but after producting, the multiplication result should be equal. So how many x? P minus 1, so x p minus 1. And then 1 times 2 times p minus 1 is equal 1 times 2 times p minus 1 in mod p. Okay? what of the inverse of one? So inverse, we don't need the root of one, right? One is equal. So is there an inverse of two in mod p? Or is there any inverse of p minus one is existing in mod p? Yes, because p minus one is belonging to the g p star. Because every element is relative prime to the p, right? So every element from one to the p minus one has inverse. Inverse. So if we are inverse in both terms, then this can be one removed and remove. And we can remove everything. So x minus x to the p minus one is one. So finally, we get this result. Okay. So you have to look at this one. And next time we will look at the Euler's theorem, which is extension of this Fermat theorem. Okay, so this is extended to the Euler's theorem. So Fermat theorem case, it is GP star, so P is prime. Euler's theorem is GN star, so N is just integer, so it's more general. So Fermat theorem case, x times p minus one, mod p is one. And next time we look at the Euler theorem. So x times something, so we'll learn about that, mod n will be one, okay? So next time we will learn about this Euler's theorem. Any question? Okay, so then see you on Wednesday. Bye.